Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present Chopping Spree by Diane Mott Davidson. Narrated by Barbara Rosenblat.
Getting and spending, we lay waste our powers. Little we see in nature that is ours. We have given our hearts away, a sordid boon. From The World Is Too Much With Us by William Wordsworth. Princess without the price tag, jewelry leasing extravaganza. Elite Shoppers Lounge, Westside Mall, Monday, April 11th, 6 to 8 in the evening. Hors d'oeuvre buffet. Crown of cheeses, brie, gorgonzola, gruyere, sharp English cheddar, camembert. Herb brioche crostini, homemade crackers and corn chips. Tiaras of strawberries, raspberries, blueberries, and starfruit with creamy fruit dressing. Empress empanadas with guacamole and sour cream. Sweetheart's Swedish meatballs in burgundy sauce. Golden shrimp rolls with spicy sauce. Diamond Lover's hot crab dip. Shoppers' chocolate truffles. Cocktails, premium wines and beers, coffee, tea, chai, and espresso drinks. Chapter 1. Success can kill you. So my best friend had been telling me anyway. Too much success is like arsenic in chocolate cake. Eat a slice a day, Marla announced with a sweep of her plump, bejeweled fingers, and you'll get cancer. Gobble the whole cake, you'll keel over and die on the spot. These observations, made over the course of a snowy March, had not cheered me. Besides, I'd have thought that Marla, with her inherited wealth and passion for shopping, would applaud the upward leap of my catering business, but she said she was worried about me. Frankly, I was worried about me, too. In mid-March, I'd invited Marla over to taste cookies. Despite a sudden but typical Colorado blizzard, she'd roared over to our small house off Aspen Meadows Main Street in her shiny new BMW four-wheel drive. Sitting in our commercial kitchen, she'd munched on ginger snaps and spice cookies and harped on the fact that the newly frantic pace of my work had coincided with my 14-year-old son Arch's increasingly rotten behavior. I knew Marla doted on Arch. But in this, too, she was right. Arch's foray into athletics, begun that winter with snowboarding and a stint on his school's fencing team, had ended with a trophy, a sprained ankle, and an unprecedented burst of physical self-confidence. He'd been eager to plunge into spring sports. When he'd decided on lacrosse, I'd been happy for him. That changed when I attended the first game. Watching my son forcefully shove an opponent aside and steal the ball, I'd felt queasy. With Arch's father, a rich doctor who'd had many violent episodes himself, now serving time for parole violation, all that slashing and hitting was more than I could take. But even more worrisome than the sport itself, Marla and I agreed, were Arch's new teammates, an unrepentant gang of spoiled, acquisitive brats. Unfortunately, Arch thought the lacrosse guys were beyond cool. He spent hours with them, claiming that he forgot to tell us where he was going after practice. We could have sent him an email telling him to call, Arch protested, if he only had what all his pals had, to wit, internet access watches. Your own watch could have told you what time it was, I told him, when I picked him up from the country club estate where the senior who was supposed to drive him home had left him off. Arch ignored me. These new friends, he'd announced glumly, also had global positioning system calculators, model bazillion Palm Pilots, and electric acoustic guitars that cost $800 and up. These litanies were always accompanied with not-so-tactful reminders that his 15th birthday was right around the corner. He wanted everything on his list, he announced as he tucked a scroll of paper into my purse. After all, with all the parties I'd booked, I could finally afford to get him some really good stuff. And no telling what'll happen if I don't get what I want, he'd added darkly. Marla informed me that he'd already given her a list. I'd shrugged as Arch clopped into the house ahead of me. I'd started stuffing sautéed chicken breasts with wild rice and spinach. The next day, Tom had picked up Arch at another friend's house. When my son waltzed into the kitchen, I almost didn't recognize him. His head was shaved.
"They bicked me," he declared,
tossing a lime into the air and catching it in the net of his lacrosse stick. "They bicked you?" I exclaimed incredulously.
"Bick, Mom, like the razor?"
He rubbed his bare scalp, then flipped the lime again.
"And I would have been home on time if you'd bought me the palm to remind me to tell the guy shaving my head that I had to go."
I snagged the lime in midair. "Go start on your homework, Buster. You got a C on the last anatomy test, and from now on, either Tom or I pick you up right from practice." On his way out of the kitchen, he whacked his lacrosse stick on the floor. I called after him, "Please not to do that." I got no reply. The next day, much to Arch's sulking chagrin, Tom had picked him up directly from practice.
"If being athletic is what success at school looks like," Tom told me, "then maybe Arch should take up painting."
I kept mum. The next day, I was ashamed to admit I'd pulled out Arch's birthday list and bought him the Palm Pilot. Call it working mom's guilt, I'd thought, as I stuffed tiny cream puffs with shrimp salad. Still, I was not sorry. I was making more money than ever before. I did not regret that Goldilocks Catering, where everything is just right, had gone from booked to overbooked. Finally, I was giving those caterers in Denver, 40 miles to the east, a run for their shrimp rolls. This is what I had always wanted. Right? "Take my best upcoming week," I'd explained to Marla as she moved on to test my cheesecake bars and raspberry brownies. "The second week of April, I would make close to $10,000, a record. I'd booked an upscale cocktail party at Westside Mall, a wedding reception, and two big luncheons. Once I survived all that, Friday, April the 15th, was Arch's birthday. By then, I'd finally have the cash to buy him something, as Arch himself had said, really good.
"Goldie, don't do that," Marla warned as she downed one of my new Spice of Life cookies.
The buttery cookies featured large amounts of ginger, cinnamon, and freshly grated nutmeg, and were as comforting as anything from Grandma's kitchen.
"You'll be too exhausted even to make a birthday cake. Listen to me now. You need to decrease your bookings, hire some help, be stricter with Arch, and take care of yourself for a change. If you don't, you're going to die."
Marla was always one for the insightful observation. I didn't listen. At least, not soon enough. The time leading up to that lucrative week in April became even busier and more frenetic. Arch occasionally slipped away from practice before Tom, coming up from his investigative work at the sheriff's department, could snag him. I was unable to remember the last time I'd had a decent night's sleep. So I suppose it was inevitable that at 10:20 in the morning of April 11th, I had what's known in the shrink business as a crisis. At least, that's what they'd called it years ago, during my pursuit of a singularly unhelpful degree in psychology. I was inside our walk-in refrigerator when I blacked out. Just before hitting the walk-in's cold floor, I grabbed a metal shelf. Plastic bags of tomatoes, scallions, celery, shallots, and ginger root spewed in every direction, and my bottom thumped the floor. I thought, "I don't have time for this!" I struggled to get up and belatedly realized this meltdown wasn't that hard to figure out. I'd been up since 5 a.m., With one of the luncheon preps done, I was focusing on the mall cocktail party that evening. Or at least, I had been focusing on it before my eyes, legs, and back gave out. I groaned and quickly gathered the plastic bags. My back ached. My mind threw out the realization that I still did not know where Arch had been for 3 hours the previous afternoon, when lacrosse practice had been canceled. Neither Tom nor I had been aware of the calendar change. Tom had finally collected Arch from a seedy section of Denver's Colfax Avenue. So what had this about-to-turn-15-year-old been up to this time? Arch had refused to say. "Just do the catering," I announced to the empty refrigerator. I replaced the plastic bags and asked the Almighty for perspective. Arch would get the third degree when he came down for breakfast. Meanwhile, I had work to do. Before falling on my behind, I'd been working on a concoction I dubbed Shopper's Chocolate Truffles. These rich goodies featured a dense, smooth chocolate interior coated with more satiny chocolate. So, what had I been looking for in the refrigerator? I had no idea. I stomped out and slammed the door. I sagged against the counter and told myself the problem was fatigue. Or maybe my age, 34, was kicking in. What would Marla say? She'd waggle a fork in my face and preach about the wages of success. I brushed myself off and quick-stepped to the sink. As water gushed over my hands, I remembered I'd been searching for the scoops of ganache, that sinfully rich mélange of melted bittersweet chocolate, heavy cream, and liqueur that made up the heart of the truffles. I dried my hands and resolved to concentrate on dark chocolate, not the darker side of success. After all, I had followed one of Marla's suggestions. I had hired help. But I hadn't cut back on parties. I'd forgotten what taking care of myself even felt like, and I seemed incapable of being stricter with Arch. I scanned the kitchen. The ganache balls, still wrapped, sat pristinely on the marble counter. Next to it, my double boiler steamed on the stovetop. Okay, so I'd already taken them out. I'd simply forgotten. I hustled over to my new kitchen computer and booted it up, intent on checking that evening's assignment. Soon, my new printer was spitting out lists of needed foodstuffs, floor plans, and scheduled setup. I may have lost my mind, but I'd picked it right up again. "This is what happens when you give up caffeine," I snarled at the ganache balls. Oops, that was twice I'd talked to myself in the last 5 minutes. Marla would not approve. I tugged the plastic wrap off the globes of ganache and spooned up a sample to check the consistency. The smooth, intense, dark chocolate sent a zing of pleasure up my back. I moved to the stovetop, stirred the luxurious pool of melting chocolate, and took a whiff of the intoxicatingly rich scent. I told myself, silently, that everything was going to be all right. The party goers were going to love me. The client for that night's cocktail party was Barry Dean, an old friend who was now manager of Westside Mall, an upscale shopping center abutting the foothills of West Denver. I'd previously put on successful catered parties at Westside. Each time, the store owners had raved. But Barry Dean, who'd only been managing the mall for 6 months, had seemed worried about the party's dessert offering. I'd promised him his high-end spenders, for whom the party was geared, would flip over the truffles. Maybe I'd even get a big tip, I thought, as I scraped down the sides of the double boiler. I could spend it on a new mattress. On it, I might eventually get some sleep. I stopped and took 3 deep breaths. My system craved coffee. Of course, I hadn't given up espresso entirely. I was just trying to cut back from 9 shots a day to 2. Too much caffeine was causing my sleeplessness, Marla had declared. Of course, since we'd both been married to the same doctor, consecutively, not concurrently. She and I were self-proclaimed experts on all physical ailments. Midwives 101, we called it. So I'd actually heeded her advice. My plan had been to have one shot at 8 in the morning, a distant memory, another at 4 in the afternoon, too far in the future. Now, my resolve was melting faster than the dark chocolate. I fired up the espresso machine and wondered how I'd gotten into such a mental and physical mess. Innocently enough, my mind replied. Without warning, right after Valentine's Day, my catering business had taken off. An influx of ultra-wealthy folks to Denver and the mountain area west of the Mile High City had translated into massive construction of trophy homes, purchases of multiple upscale cars, and doubling of prices for just about everything. Most important from my viewpoint, the demand for big-ticket catered events had skyrocketed. From mid-February to the beginning of April, a normally slow season, my assignments had exploded. I'd thought I'd entered a zone, as they say in Boulder, of bliss. I pulled a double shot of espresso, then took a sip and felt infinitely better. I rolled the first silky scoop of ganache into a ball and set it aside. What had I been thinking about? Ah, yes. Success. I downed more coffee and set aside the porcelain bought-on-clearance cup. A remnant of my financial dark days. Those days had lasted a long time, a fact that Arch seemed to block out. When I began divorce proceedings against the ultra-cute, ultra-vicious Dr. John Richard Corman, I'd been so determined that he would support our son well that I'd become an official nosy person. Files, tax returns, credit card receipts, check stubs, bank deposits. I'd found and studied them all. My zealous curiosity had metamorphosed into a decent settlement. Wasn't it Benjamin Franklin who'd said, "God helps those who help themselves"? Old Ben had been right. I bathed the first dark ganache globe in the chocolate. Okay, I'd replaced marital bitterness with bitter sweet chocolate and bitter orange marmalade, right? And my life had turned around. 2 years ago, I'd married Tom Schulz. As unreal as my newly minted financial success might seem, I did not doubt the miracle of my relationship with Tom, whose work as a police investigator had actually brought us together in the first place. Tom was big-hearted and open-armed toward both Arch and me. So far, Tom and I had passed the tests that had been flung our way and emerged still together. In this day and age, I thought, such commitment was commendable. And yet, I reflected as I placed the sumptuous truffle on a rack to dry, one of the reasons I'd been so happy about my sudden financial success was that I'd vowed never to depend on Tom's income. My earnings were now on a par with Tom's. After the money battles with the jerk, financial independence was a phenomenon I'd sworn to attain and keep. Unfortunately, before marrying Tom, my profits had stayed in a zone between can feed Arch and keep gas in van, to going down fast, write for law school catalogs. I rolled ganache balls, bathed them in chocolate, and set them aside to dry. Scoop, bathe, set aside. Marla would grouse all she wanted. I savored my new success. I was even considering purchasing a new set of springform pans, since I'd already bought a new computer, printer, and copier, not to mention new tableware, flatware, and knives. A shining set of silver Henkels. I relished no longer renting plates, silverware, and linens. I laughed aloud when I finished the 20th truffle and made myself another espresso. The dark drink tasted divine. No wonder they called financial solvency liquidity. I rewarded myself with a forkful of ganache, which sparked more fireworks of chocolate ecstasy. I did a little two-step and thanked the Almighty for chocolate, coffee, and business growth. Roll, bathe, set aside. I was appreciative that I had scads of new clients. In hiring me, they offered testimonies from friends, Marla in particular, or claimed they'd caught the reruns of my short-lived PBS cooking show. Some even said they just had to hire this caterer they'd read about, the one who helped her husband solve the occasional murder case. Well, why they hired me didn't matter. New clients were new clients, and glitzy parties paid the bills. It had been stupendous. For a while. Now I looked and felt like Zabalion, frothy after being beaten too hard, and I was unsure of what was going on with my son. I rolled, bathed, and set aside more truffles, all the while avoiding my reflection in the kitchen window. I knew what I'd see there, a haggard face with licorice black bags under bloodshot eyes, not to mention a fretwork of worried wrinkles. My freshly shampooed, too busy to get a cut blonde hair, which people had always likened to Shirley Temple's corkscrew curls, now gave me the look of a soaked poodle. "You're obsessing again," I scolded myself as I set the 30th truffle on the rack. "You'll just make things worse." I focused on the ganache, as if to prove my truffles were indeed worthy of West Side's best-heeled shoppers. I'd offered one from an earlier batch to handsome brown-haired Barry Dean, who, years ago, had taken a psych class with me at the University of Colorado. Back then, he'd flirted with me. He'd given me notes when I missed a lecture. He'd taken me out in his Mercedes for coffee after class. I'd patted his basset hound, Honey, who lay in regal repose on a blanket in the back seat. Tucking into our cappuccinos, lattes, and espressos con panna, Barry and I prided ourselves on being the only two coffee connoisseurs on the Boulder campus. I'd enjoyed our outings immensely. The previous week, I'd given him the chocolate during our second meeting in West Side's new shopper's lounge. Quickly downing three truffles, Barry had vented his frustration over the chronic delays in West Side's second remodeling in 5 years. His construction manager had quit in a huff and moved to Arizona. His volatile excavator promised one thing, then did another. Since I'd had my own remodeling disaster, I'd murmured sympathetically. Barry had eaten six more truffles. The man was stressed out as we hammered out the party details. He offered to drive me back to my van. On the way, he promised, as he downed his 10th truffle, he'd take me out for coffee. Just like the old days. At the espresso drive-thru known as the West Side Buzz, the barista had recognized Barry. A Denver newspaper had just named him the Mile High City's most eligible bachelor, and the barista went nuts. After she got over squealing, making change, and handing us our drinks, Barry had demonstrated the turbo on his new Saab, bought because someone had crashed into his Mercedes to zoom away. At a red light, he'd shown me the car's stereo, CD player, fan ventilation of perforated leather seats, and other bells and whistles. The man loved cars, no question about it. I'd laughed and asked if he wanted another truffle. He'd placed his drink into the retractable cup holder, mouthed a drum roll, and popped another truffle, his 11th, into his mouth. To my delight, he'd opened his gorgeous brown eyes wide and yodeled as he soared into a state of chocolate euphoria. Upon recovering, he'd ordered 60. He feigned amnesia and panted, "Construction? What construction?" I smiled, remembering. I bathed the 40th ganache ball in dark chocolate, set it on the rack, and gave it a stiff appraisal. I had to admit, it had amnesia potential. I took a deep breath and ordered myself not to indulge in another taste until all 60 of the chocolates were made. Instead, I had to start planning Arch's birthday. At the moment, Arch was asleep as the Elk Park prep teachers were meeting for an in-service. School that day didn't start till noon, my son had announced the previous night, and could we spend the morning shopping? I'd said, no, I had to work. And besides, where had he been the previous day? He'd sighed. Then he pushed his glasses up his nose so he could give me the full benefit of his pleading eyes, which seemed huge against the background of his shaved head. Had I started purchasing any items on his birthday list? He asked. I swallowed. I'd only bought the palm. I hadn't had time for anything else. Arch had hoisted his book bag and stalked out of the kitchen. I yelled after him that no matter how much money you had, it was never enough. He'd called back something unintelligible. I rolled another ball of ganache and longed to stuff it into my mouth. Instead, I dipped it into the dark chocolate. Marla's warnings haunted me. What exactly was enough? On our day of planning, Barry Dean had told me about the jewelry event come cocktail party guests, members of the West Side's elite shoppers club. The elites, as Barry called them, spent a minimum of $1,000 a week at the mall. Membership in the group guaranteed special coupons, special sales, valet parking, and events like the jewelry leasing extravaganza I was catering that night. One thing I had asked Barry, where did the elites put all the stuff they bought? He'd winked, done his endearing bachelor shrug, and said usually they rented storage sheds. Perhaps buying wasn't the future of retail, Barry had added. Take jewelry leasing, for example, for which there was no need to store anything permanently. You too, Goldie, for 2,000, 4,000, or 6,000 bucks a month, could wear a different piece of ultra-glam jewelry every 30 days, 20% off the cost of the yearly lease for all mall employees. I'd laughed and told him that none of the pieces I'd glimpsed, diamond, emerald, ruby, and sapphire necklaces, matched a single one of my aprons. My business line rang. I put down the truffle, wiped my fingers on my stained apron, and actually prayed that this was not another new client. Goldilocks catering. You're working, Marla accused. No, really. I was sleeping in. Then my best friend called and woke me up. Yeah, sure. She swallowed something. I guessed it was her latest version of hot chocolate, which consisted of hot cream, cocoa, and low-cal sweetener. Even though Marla had had a heart attack almost 2 years before, she'd had little luck losing weight on a low-fat, high-carb, low-protein diet. So now she was trying a some-fat, some-carb, high-protein diet. She claimed she'd lost 6 pounds and felt much better. When I'd asked her what her cardiologist thought of the new regimen, she'd hung up on me. You had to be careful with Marla. Now I said, okay, I was trying to roll truffles, until my best friend called and forced me to smear chocolate all over my new apron. Quit belly aching. She started munching on something. I didn't want to imagine what. Yesterday, I gave Arch a package for you. It's in your freezer. I want you to open it. I sighed, thinking of all the work I had to do. While I'm talking to you, if you don't mind. I knew my life would be much easier if I just tucked the phone against my shoulder, wrenched open the freezer door of the walk-in, and did as bidden. So I did. After a moment of groping, I pulled a very cold brown paper bag from a shelf. The bag contained, oh joy, a pint of Häagen-Dazs coffee ice cream, hand-labeled A, and a brown bottle of time-release vitamins marked B. Okay, get a spoon and a glass of water, Marla commanded when she heard the paper rustling. Take a spoonful of A, then a capsule of B. Now. I again followed orders. The ice cream improved my mood, no question. But when I tried to swallow the vitamin, I choked. I can't believe you're doing the event tonight, Marla cried, not heeding my wheezing gasps. You'll wreck my shopping experience and everyone else's. You think people want a caterer who looks half dead? Shoppers want to escape reality, Goldie. They want to feel rich. They want to feel young. They'll take one look at you and say, why should I shop? She's going to die, and so am I. I finally swallowed the vitamin and croaked. Are you done talking about me kicking the bucket? Because I've got truffles to coat. No, Marla wailed. I need to bitch some more, and you're the only one who's home. I refired the espresso machine, tucked the phone against my ear, and resumed work on the truffles. Marla went on, her husky voice laced with anger. I was going to lease the double strand of diamonds for the first month. They're perfect for the March of Dimes luncheon, but 6,000 a month? What'll I have left to give the March of Dimes? She paused to devour more food. One of the whole grain muffins I'd made her? Unlikely. Then I heard that Paige Stockham, also an elite shopper, wanted the same necklace. So now I'm trying to decide between a ruby chain and an emerald set in 3 rows of diamonds, in case Paige gets it first. Oh, Paige Stockham just makes me so angry. And to think I asked her to go with me to tonight's event. To think, I murmured sympathetically. She ignored me. Making matters even worse, Ellie McNeely wants the double pearl strand with the aquamarine, which I've had my eye on forever, to go with a dinner I'm giving in May that I was hoping you'd cater, if you're not dead. Wait a minute. There's someone at the door. I mm-hmm'd and continued dipping. L.A. McNeely, whom I'd done fundraising with over a decade ago in the Episcopal Church Women, was an old friend from my rich doctor's wife years, one of the few old friends who'd remained a pal in my post-divorce service industry years. Paige Stockham was the wife of Shane Stockham, Arch's lacrosse coach, and I knew her not at all. But the key fact from a caterer's perspective was that Paige, Ellie, and Marla all had money to burn. Waiting for Marla to return to the phone, I kept on with the truffles. 6 to go, row, bathe, set aside. What had I been thinking about? Oh, yes, money to burn. I wasn't resentful, though, because moneyed folks were my best clients. And anyway, who was I to judge anyone else's shopping? My eyes traveled to the carved wooden cupboard hanging over our kitchen table. I truly did not want to look down on folks who engaged in retail therapy. The reason was that during my divorce from the jerk, and despite near dire financial straits, I'd been a shop-to-feel-better gal myself. On weekends, when it was John Richard's turn to have Arch, I'd visited every shopping center I could find. I'd strolled through perfume-scented air by gorgeously stacked goods, past gaggle after gaggle of smiling, prosperous people. I'd loitered in front of brightly lit displays of embroidered baby clothes, rainbow-hued designer sheets, sleek copper pots and pans, even sugared sparkling cinnamon rolls. I'd allowed myself to feel rich, even if my bank account said otherwise. Come to think of it, maybe that was what Arch had been doing the previous day, shopping. Still, there weren't any luxury shops on East Colfax. I retucked the silent phone against my ear, rolled another truffle, but stopped again to ponder the cupboard shelves. On each of those long-ago shopping trips, I'd bought myself a little something from the drastically reduced tables. My white porcelain demi-tasse cup and saucer, a tiny crystal mouse, a miniature wooden car laden with painted wooden gifts. All these had made me uncommonly happy. At home, I'd placed my minuscule treasures on the old cupboard's shelves. Without the store's strong overhead lights, the little crystal mouse hadn't looked quite so brilliant, The cheap china cup had lost its translucence, but I'd never cared. Each piece had been mine, something for me, a small token of an inner voice too long silenced saying, I love you. So who was I to judge Marla or her friends, Paige Stockham and Ellie McNeely? They all wanted someone, even if it was themselves, to say, I really, really care about you, and to prove it, have this. Marla came back to the phone and said Ellie had arrived, and she had to go. Before the event, she, Ellie, and Paige, who was driving down separately with husband Shane, would be getting the mud soak, the coconut milk bath, and the vegetable and fruit wrap at Westside Spa. I'll watch for a moving luau. I'll catch you at the party, Marlo retorted, undaunted, and signed off. I rolled the 58th truffle. Then, lowering the scoop of ganache into the melted chocolate and setting it aside to dry, I made another espresso. To the far west, just visible out our back windows, a bright mist cloaked the mountains of the Aspen Meadow Wildlife Preserve. On the nearer hills, white-barked aspens nestled between dark expanses of fir, spruce, and pine. I peered at our thermometer. The red line was stubbornly stuck at 29 degrees. So, this is springtime in the Rockies? Newcomers always asked. This is it, I invariably replied. In June, you can take off your snow tires. I slugged down what I vowed would be my last coffee. Once again, worry surfaced. Where had Arch been yesterday? The rumor was that the rookies on the lacrosse team had been told their initiation would not be complete until they shoplifted something worth more than $50. Thinking about that possibility, my heart plummeted. I disciplined myself to roll the next-to-last truffle. It broke into two pieces when I dunked it in the dark chocolate. Oh, darn. Guess I'll have to eat it. Maybe with a fifth espresso. I pulled out the chocolate chunks swimming in the dark coating, placed them on the rack, then refilled the espresso doser. I rinsed the old porcelain demitasse cup and closed my eyes. Worry for Arch nagged at me. I balanced on one foot. I was so tired. And then my much-loved cup slipped from my fingers. It shattered on the floor with a heartbreaking crash. Shards raced across the wood. Bits of china smashed into the molding and sent reverberating tinkles throughout the kitchen. My best shopping treasure was gone. Later, I tried not to think of it as an omen. Chapter 2. I swept up the mess and went back to work. I was cloaking the final ganache globe with chocolate when Tom and Arch banged into the kitchen. Arch was clutching his usual 65 pounds of books, electronic gadgets, and athletic equipment. Lots and lots of athletic equipment. At the second lacrosse game, I'd watched in horror as a forward had come barreling down the field, bearing down on Arch. My formerly passive son set himself into a tough gladiator defensive stance. When Arch pushed his weight into the forward's chest, the kid went flying. The team wildly applauded my son. I thought I was going to be ill. The lacrosse players weren't the only thing that upset me about Elk Park Prep. The majority of EPP students were rich, undisciplined, and self-centered. A minority wreaked true havoc. Unfortunately, most of this contingent's bad behavior, throwing acid on kids in chem lab, drinking to the point of oblivion at football games, stealing liquor for house parties when parents were absent, went unpunished. I'd longed to call our local rag, the Mountain Journal, to report these incidents after hearing about them at parties I'd catered, but Arch had made me swear not to. I often wondered about where all the misbehavior would lead. Unfortunately, the EPP teachers and administrators kissed the feet of the biggest donors. But besides the killer lacrosse and lack of consequences for big-time mischief, what bothered me most these days was EPP's freewheeling curriculum. Take that anatomy class. On second thought, don't. This week, I was driving a contingent of Arch's classmates to Lutheran Hospital, where they would dissect a cadaver. I sighed. Get used to it, I always told myself. With the Furman County Public School student-teacher ratio at 50 to 1, and with Elk Park's hefty tuition coming out of the jerk's hoard of cash, getting used to it was exactly what I needed to do. I set the last truffle aside to dry and glanced at Tom. He looked dashing in a white shirt, gray pants, and my favorite wool sweater, a crew neck pullover the color of oatmeal. His brown hair was combed up at a jaunty angle, and his spicy aftershave wafted my way. I hurried over and kissed him on the cheek. He smooched my forehead and asked if I'd like more coffee. Dear Tom. He'd known my attempt to cut back on caffeine would be short-lived. I said yes, then patted Arch on the shoulder, which was all the maternal affection he'd allow these days. My son, now surpassing me in height, not hard since I'm 5'2", slid away hastily and adjusted his new John Lennon-style wire-rimmed glasses. The previous month, I'd offered to buy him contacts. He'd replied that what he really wanted was laser surgery. He'd need $8,000, though, to get the great surgeon the Elk Park kids used. I'd bought him new glasses. Checking his reflection in the window, Arch ducked his chin to assess the new tobacco brown fuzz on his scalp. He then checked his choker of shell bits, smoothed the oversized khakis and rumpled plaid shirt that were the school's unofficial uniform, and frowned. Something was bothering him. Arch, I ventured rashly, where were you yesterday afternoon?
What's it to you?
Is that polite? I asked.
Is it polite to be nosy?
I gave up. Tom offered me a cream-laced espresso. It was my sixth of the morning. Amazing how these things add up. I slurped the fragrant drink, blissfully similar to hot coffee ice cream, and faced my next task. Breakfast for Arch. Lacrosse players, I was always telling him, needed a large morning meal so they could build the strength to pound on each other. I retrieved English muffins, eggs, butter, and jam, and tried to ignore the fact that Arch was guzzling an energy drink. When I'd said I was giving up caffeine, he'd advised me to switch to the bottled concoction known as Virtuous Vigor. I'd tried one swig and choked. Tom, Arch, in 10 minutes I can give you a late breakfast or an early lunch. Your choice.
No time, Mom.
Arch replied as he simultaneously tossed the energy drink bottle into the trash and snagged another one.
Ready to go, Tom?
When Tom replied that he was, Arch said,
Oops, I need to get my spare long stick.
The long stick, I'd learned, is what the lacrosse defenseman uses to scoop up the ball after he sends a forward into the air or onto the ground. As Arch galloped back up the stairs, I banged the eggs back onto the fridge shelf and slammed the door closed.
He'll be fine, Tom murmured as he hugged me. After I pick him up at practice, we'll make your favorite beef stew, ready when you get home from the mall.
Arch gets plenty of good nutrition.
Frankly, in the health department, it's you I worry about, Miss G.
I'm fine.
No.
My husband countered.
You're not. You need to cut back, Goldie. You're exhausted.
Would you like something to eat? He kissed me again, then stepped back.
When I get down to the sheriff's department, they'll have donuts waiting.
He smiled.
Just kidding. Listen, after I leave Arch off, why don't you let me pick up some sandwiches for you and Liz?
Liz Fury was the assistant I'd hired at Marla's behest. Liz had been a godsend. Tom concluded, "I can be back in an hour. Interested?" I shook my head as unexpected tears pricked my eyes. When you endure 7 years of being belted around by a jerk, kindness comes as a shock. Guess I was more tired than I thought. "Thanks, but no," I said hastily. "If Liz and I can get all our work done, we'll grab a bite at the mall. Then..." Arch banged back into the room. He was now toting the long stick in one hand, the second energy drink in the other. "West Side Mall?" he interrupted. I nodded. His eyes brightened. "West Side Music just put the $1,500 Epiphone on sale for $700. It's the exact guitar I need, Mom. And they only have one. And the gadget guy is having a mega sale, so everything is 50%. Stop," I said, too loudly. At least I didn't scream. $700? West Side Music has one guitar on sale, Mom. By tonight, it'll be gone. I swore I'd check it out, then gave each of them a wrapped truffle for a mid-afternoon snack. With an air of being put upon, Arch tucked the truffle into his book bag, pawed through his athletic carrier, and announced he was missing his Palm Pilot and cell phone. And did I know where they were? I did not. Arch banged back up the stairs, and I gave Tom a look. My son has become a materialist.
It's the age, Goldie.
But where was he yesterday? What if he ends up shoplifting like those other Elk Park prep kids?
Goldie, come on. Only one of those kids we caught was from Elk Park prep, and he was carrying goods from a pen store, a leather boutique, and Victoria's Secret.
Tom slipped into his jacket.
Plus, your pal, Barry Dean, whose stores buy more advertising than God, has installed a new state-of-the-art security system at Westside. He's even threatened to bar certain kids from the mall.
I shook my head. I thought of my broken cup shards in the trash and shuddered.
Tom jangled his keys. With shaking hands, I picked up the foodstuffs list to begin my checkoff. Finally, Arch slammed back into the kitchen. He slipped a handful of electronic accoutrements into his backpack, then yanked up the bag in a practiced motion. In so doing, his untucked shirt revealed the skin of his back. I gasped. The bottom fourth of Arch's back was inked with a tattoo of a lacrosse stick.
"Mother of God!" I exclaimed.
"What's the matter?" Tom demanded, startled.
I croaked. "So that's where you were yesterday. At a tattoo..."
I couldn't finish. "Back off, Mom," Arch yelled.
I...
"May I say it, Arch?" Tom interposed quietly. Eyeing me furiously, Arch faced me and lifted his shirt so Tom could inspect his back. "Well, well," said Tom. "A tattoo. Had any bleeding or swelling?"
"No."
Arch flipped down his shirt, tucked it in, and announced he'd forgotten one more thing upstairs, his anatomy class assignment. I sank into a chair.
"I'm losing my grip," I moaned.
"Hate to tell you, Miss G, but that's what you're supposed to do with an almost 15-year-old.
He stroked my cheek and kissed me again.
"Just concentrate on the cooking. Julian's helping you today?" he asked. "Along with Liz?"
I took two deep yoga-style breaths.
Liz Fury was good, but 22-year-old Julian Teller, our one-time boarder and close family friend, was, in my opinion, the best young gourmet cook in Colorado.
"They're both helping," I answered.
"Plus," I added mentally, "Julian was close to Arch and might have some ideas about dealing with adolescents. Maybe Julian had tattoos, too."
"You're sure you're going to be all right, Miss G?"
I opened my eyes wide. I wasn't sure of anything.
"Tom, I'll be fine. Julian's leaving Boulder at 1, meeting us at the mall at 2.
"Okay, listen,"
Arch interjected as he traipsed back into the kitchen and deftly nabbed a third energy drink.
Could you tell Julian I need a chocolate cake with vanilla frosting for my birthday? You'll probably be too busy to do anything, and Julian always makes me a terrific cake, he added. Arch! One Epiphone on sale, Mom! One!
Tom winked at me and waved. The back door banged behind them. A moment later, Tom's engine growled in the driveway. My heart ached. Was I a failure as a mother? If I bought the expensive guitar, would I be succumbing to acquisitiveness? If I didn't buy it, would Arch get more tattoos? Before I could answer these questions, however, there was a frenzied knocking at the front door. My peephole revealed Liz Fury.
Where's your husband going this time of day? Is everything okay? Liz demanded.
I stepped out onto the porch. He's just taking Arch to school. Late start.
Oh.
Liz, an early 40s single mom, was gifted with food and efficient at catering. With her tall, slender figure, attractive face set off by sapphire eyes and chopped silver blonde hair, she even looked the part. Or at least she looked the way most people visualize an upscale caterer. She didn't look chic just at that moment, though. In the cold April wind, her hair had all blown to one side. Her cheeks and nose were red, and she looked less like a hip caterer than a silver-haired doll with a punk haircut. Tom and Arch zoomed away. Liz, clutching a bag, hastened past me toward the kitchen. Under her coat, it looked as if she was wearing dressier than usual clothes. I'd seen Liz talking earnestly with Barry Dean while we did the lounge measurements. Maybe she was trying to impress the most eligible bachelor. And maybe I was becoming too obsessed with other folks' issues. I marched into the kitchen.
What are we doing first? Liz asked as her eyes swept the room. Why were Tom and Arch in such a hurry?
I don't know. I truly did not know what Tom was doing today, but I'd finally learned a thing or two as a cop's wife, among them, regarding police work. Keep your mouth shut. And anyway, I'd forgotten to ask what Tom's plans were. I'd been sidetracked by Arch's tattoo.
I got that expensive burgundy. You're right, though, it will make a difference.
Liz banged bottles onto the counter, then hung up her coat and washed her hands. I complimented her on her outfit, shimmery white silk shirt, spotless black silk sweater, and wrinkled silk gray pants, undoubtedly remnants of her high-flying days as a party planner and caterer for a high-flying corporation that had gone under. When her employer had declared bankruptcy, she'd tried to find work with other big-spending companies, but the new big guns in town had brought their own party planners. With no savings, Liz had ended up begging for food stamps. If I were in her position, I'd shut up single guys, too. Without thinking, I said, "Going somewhere after we finish tonight?" "Well," she replied, with a smile, as she tied her apron over her beautiful clothes. "Maybe." She lowered velvety lashes over her dark blue eyes. "Not that I'd ever tell my boss about my social life." "Sorry," I mumbled. A grin flitted across Liz's heart-shaped mouth as she retrieved a wide frying pan and containers of reserved beef drippings and clarified butter. I packed up the first container of truffles while she whisked flour into the melted fat, set the heat to low, and pulled out the beef stock. As I covered layer after layer of chocolate, Liz slowly stirred the stock into the roux until it thickened. Leaving it to heat, she went back to the refrigerator and perused the contents.
"Goldy, what else do we have left to do?"
"Shrimp rolls. You can check the crab dip. I've got 2 pages of printout over there. Could you bring me the grilled shrimp?" Liz brought out the vat of shrimp, then perused the printout. A moment later, she dove back into the depths of the refrigerator. She bumped around for a bit, then called,
"What'd you do, work all night on the Stockholm lunch?"
"Just trying to get ahead. We've got that party, plus Barry's lessee lunch the following day."
"What else are we doing for Shane? Calculators from sardines? Whole mushrooms in the shape of digital cameras?"
Just finish the meatballs, would you, Liz?
She emerged with the metal container that held our meticulously rolled and browned mixture of lean ground beef, heavy cream, freshly grated nutmeg, and other goodies.
While she stirred the high-priced burgundy into the meatball sauce, I arranged fat shrimp, thin noodles, fragrant chopped cilantro, and shredded carrot, broccolini, and black mushrooms into the shrimp rolls. Before we started on our last dishes, the crab dip and cheese trays, we treated ourselves to 8 leftover shrimp and the last 4 leftover truffles. It wasn't a meal Elk Park Prep would highlight in their nutrition class. But so what? We were caterers. An hour later, we entered the last stage of prep, cleaning our pots, pans, and tools, going over our checklists, and packing up our vehicles. When Liz still had her corporate job, her last financial gasp had been to buy, on credit, a silver Toyota van. It was a great car, and roomy, and Liz and I were halfway through packing it when a battered green Subaru screeched to a halt outside the house. "What the?" I exclaimed. "Oh, darn it," muttered Liz. She shot me a baleful glance. "It's my kids." A boy of perhaps 17, dark-haired and gangly, jumped out of the passenger side, while a smartly dressed, beautifully bobbed young woman of about 20 extracted herself from the driver's side and slammed her door shut. "Mom!" shrieked the girl, whom I took to be Kim, Liz's super-bright daughter, an honor student at CU. "I have to have the van to get back to Boulder, or the Subaru. You can't let Teddy take a car to school today. Come on, Mom." "Kim," Liz began, "I thought you were getting a ride." Kim's dark hair bounced pertly as she strode up the driveway. "Mom," she cried again, "you know perfectly well I can't get all my stuff into a friend's car. Why do you always side with Teddy? He's a terrible driver anyway, and he's in trouble. You said so yourself. He shouldn't be going shopping after school when I need to get back."
"Kim," Liz tried again, her voice low, "please stop shouting in front of Goldie's neighbors."
"Mom," Teddy pleaded.
His shoulders slumped, his face screwed into a look of anxiety. Teddy, I knew, was something of a screw-up, although I was not aware of the details.
"I don't have a ride to school today, and I've got stuff to do later, and I'm really, really late as it is. Teddy, you're not supposed to. Please let me have the Subaru," Teddy begged, "because I know it needs an oil change. Give Kim the van. Let me have the Subaru until tonight. I'll get the oil changed, then pick you up at the mall. What time will you be finished? I can meet you at the..."
"Mom!"
Kim was livid.
"Why are you listening to him and not listening to me? I need the van, now!"
Liz's blue eyes shot me a look of such hopelessness that my heart twisted in my chest.
"Is there any way we can get everything into your van?"
Liz beseeched me.
"Of course," I said without hesitation. "Besides, I'd love your company."
She blushed, then asked if she and her kids could move the stuff over so I wouldn't be bothered. I took this as a signal that she couldn't stand being embarrassed another moment. I nodded and mumbled that I had work to do inside. Poor Liz, I thought, as I packed up the last boxes in the kitchen. She'd had her kids early, then been deserted by her husband. After the corporate job crashed and burned, she'd been left without resources.
"I'd kill to get this job with you," she'd told me 2 weeks ago, as her long, slender hands had offered me a foil cup of her signature Grand Marnier creme brulee.
I'd taken only one bite and informed her that she was hired. She'd managed to balance her schedule, money, and offspring problems until today. But we worked things out. Kim took the van. Teddy roared away triumphantly in the Subaru. An hour later, crisis over, Liz and I were on our way. My van zipped up Aspen Meadows Main Street and around the curve of the lake where ruffled dark water skirted a membrane of ice. April in the high country brings freezing temperatures, lots of snow, and only an occasional glimpse of the warmth to come. Chugging toward the interstate, we passed snowy meadows pocked with dun-colored grass. Stands of white-barked aspen looked as if they were wrapped in green mist, the first sign of emerging lime-colored leaves. Driving by Flicker Ridge, I was forced to slow by the entries to two new upscale housing developments. Trucks, tractors, and front-end loaders rumbled across denuded meadows, where a sign now screamed that there were only three sites left, next to a hand-painted offer, topsoil, $70 per load, which lay beside a large, beautifully lettered sign announcing the presence of Ace Custom Construction. Trucks labeled Ace and We Got Dirt hauled loads of soil in and out of a fenced-off area. Melting snow still chilled the air, but the building of the new crop of trophy homes, each set on a mere quarter of an acre, was clearly well underway. I turned up the van's heat. As we descended to the mile-high city, the air turned soft and warm. At my request, Liz cracked a window. Our winter in Aspen Meadow began in October and ended in May, 2 months longer than Denver and environs. By the time we arrived at the turnoff for Westside Mall, 40 miles east of home, we had emerged into a gentle spring. Not that arriving at the shopping center gave you a prospect of flowered shrubs or leafy trees. If anything, the mall's grand new stone entrance, flanked with sloping hillocks of dirt, gave the place the look of a military outpost. Barry had told me the mall landscaping had been postponed because of the construction delays. As I slowed to make the turn onto Donut Drive, the road that encircled the mall, I remembered something else Barry had told me. We're giving shoppers entertainment and discounts these days to make up for the mess. Tonight's red tag shoe sale at Prince and Grogan was the discount magnet. The catered jewelry leasing party was the entertainment. The mess was just the mess. I slowed the van and glanced in the direction of the construction, where a line of workers were putting in a winding sidewalk that would soon be dotted with inviting benches, restaurants, boutiques, and coffee kiosks. All this, Barry had told me, was more entertainment. Shoppers want picturesque spots to sit, watch the folks go by, and eat food samples, he'd said. Shoppers don't live in a storybook village, but they want to pretend they do. And, he'd added, they were under severe pressure from the mall owner, Pennybaker International, to get the new village done. Malls are getting mauled, was the message from industry insiders. Suburban folks with money in their pockets were tired of concrete parking lots leading to blank walls enclosing identical sets of stores. They wanted to see and be seen as they strolled past trees, bushes, and sculptures. They wanted to go to the bank, the dry cleaner, and the bookstore, and then have lunch at an Italian restaurant overlooking a fountain. This was exactly what all the mall owners and execs, including Barry, were trying to offer. And at some point, all those shoppers would also need to purchase dresses, cosmetics, pots, pans, and shoes, which they could do inside the mall itself, a mere 50 steps away. The best way to promote Westside, Barry had told me, was to tack a fairy tale village onto its back end. At least Barry wasn't bringing in Snow White and the Dwarves, I reflected, as my van chugged along Donut Drive. The new road was perfectly named. A 12-foot-high berm of unlandscaped soil circled the outer perimeter. At the 8-foot chain-link fence surrounding the construction area, I slowed down, then stopped at the gate. Barry wasn't there to meet us. Liz gave me a questioning look. Beyond the fence, acres of flattened dirt, what would eventually become the mall's new parking lot, sloped down to the roped-off area. There, a worker wearing a bright orange hard hat chugged around in a front-end loader, moving rocks from one enormous pile to another. The rest of the crew, clad in yellow hard hats, were clustered next to a hot dog vendor by the construction company trailer. My eyes swept left, and I barely escaped cursing aloud. The restyled back entrance to the mall, the one that led up to the elite shopper's lounge, was surrounded by a lake of muddy drainage water. At the end of this brown pond, an imposing line of enormous dump trucks obscured any view to that rear entry. Worse, the water came up to the truck's wheel wells. How were we supposed to transport boxes into the mall? By boat? As if he'd heard my worries, the man driving the loader halted abruptly and hopped onto the rocks. This had to be Victor Wilson, the excavator Barry had mentioned, who'd been promoted recently to be the new construction manager. Victor was short and chunky, with a reddish-brown ponytail sticking out from his orange hard hat. He shouted in the direction of the crew, who responded by tossing their trash and slowly moving back to the equipment on the sidewalk. I was impressed. After all the delays, it looked as if Victor was really cracking the whip. How are we going to unpack? Liz asked me. Where's Barry? Where's Julian? I scanned the drainage lake and spied a narrow wooden walkway spanning the water, curving around the row of trucks. Maybe we wouldn't have to don hip boots after all. I pointed. See that plankway in front of the trucks? If you can open the gate to the construction area, I'll drive us as close as possible. With any luck, Julian will see the van. Why did Barry even say he'd meet us at the gate? Liz asked. That's not normal, is it? For a mall manager to help the catering team? He's an old friend. I thought again of the flirtatious way she and Barry had seemed to be acting when we'd done our measuring. Then again, I'd learned in college that Barry was a seductive kind of guy. Anyway, Liz, I added mischievously, maybe Barry wanted to see you. Did Barry? Flustered, she ran her fingers through her silver blonde hair. Did he mention my name? The fact that I was helping you? Liz, stop worrying. Everything will be fine. Just get the gate, okay? She hopped out, swung open the construction gate, and waved me through. Once the gate was shut and she was back inside, we bumped over deep ruts to get as close as possible to the big puddle. We ended up parking 50 yards from the wooden walkway. I still couldn't get a good view of the mall's rear entrance. Were the trucks parked flush against the shopping center wall? Hopefully, some kind of dike had been erected behind them, providing walking space that led to the mall's entrance. If Julian and Barry didn't show up to help, and Liz and I had to skirt the truck and water mess to get to the lounge, we were going to have a devil of a time. I mentally calculated an hour and a half to haul everything in, another 90 minutes to set up and decorate the tables, another 45 to do the last-minute prep on the food and set out the platters. Since my watch now said 2 o'clock, that schedule would put us right up against 6 o'clock, party time. Liz and I heaved up the first boxes. We decided to trek down around the ruts to a foot-wide dirt path that seemed to run along the edge of the lake. The crow may fly as he may, but a smooth, longer way to the wooden plankway had to be better than negotiating hard waves of dirt. As we trod carefully on the springy plank boards, I spotted a foot-high wooden wall behind the trucks. So there was a seawall, thank goodness. Beyond it, a cement sidewalk looked dry enough for us to make it to the just-completed glass doors of the entrance. Despite the fact that I was lugging two boxes, I felt relief. Then Liz let out a little gasp. Barry Dean had pushed through the glass doors and was striding along the sidewalk. Liz and I stepped off the end of the plankway spanning the drainage lake and started up the sidewalk toward him. Clad in a bright green sport shirt, khaki pants, and loafers, Barry acknowledged us with a hearty wave. Tripping along behind him was a young woman wearing a black halter top, white short shorts, and chartreuse green platform sandals. The woman was slender-hipped and big-busted. About 30 platinum ponytails stuck out from her head. She looked like a blonde plant that had sprouted. The young woman laid her hand on Barry's arm to slow him. When he turned to face her, she did a little wiggle, showing off her outfit, demonstrating how all the ponytails could jiggle at once. I groaned. shifted my load and turned to check on Liz. She had stopped dead in her tracks. Luckily, she recovered quickly enough to grab her boxes before they fell. "Plenty of fish in the sea," I wanted to tell her. "Honestly," Liz murmured. She rebalanced her cargo, moved forward, and made her tone light. "That man would hit on my daughter." Enthusiastic honking kept me from having to reply. From between the trucks, I could see a white Range Rover rocketing over the dirt ruts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.